Hey everyone, and welcome to episode 1 of the KindGM podcast. I'm your host, Chris.
And I'm your other host, Anastasios. First of all, Happy New Year. Today is the 1st of January, as of the time we're recording this. And I hope you had a very nice 2019. And I wish an even better 2020.
Even though I choked on my coffee the moment I said, may we have a nice 2020.
Yes. With health and happiness, and then you choked. Anyway, moving on, we are here today. Chris has a bit of a time away from the army.
Yeah, I have a few days of holiday leave, and I thought it was a really good chance to record another episode, because technically this is episode 1, but there was an episode 0, which was initially uploaded on YouTube. It didn't have an episode number, it was pretty much
a review for Matt Colville's...
Yeah, we were testing the waters and it was just uploaded as a review. And we've been thinking about it and we decided to make it a
regular occurrence.
Yeah, make it a podcast. And it's already up on iTunes, so feel free to leave a like and a review if you enjoy the previous or this episode. And hopefully this episode will be a bit better sound-wise. Hopefully. I've learned a lot while editing and also while recording. Especially, I learned not to record at the house of Anastasios because the echo there is atrocious.
Yeah. Well, we were also in the most open area of the house. So...
Yeah.
Anyway, next time... We'll be even better at this. Anyway, what have you been up to?
Apart from the army?
Yeah.
I've been reading a lot. I have had the chance and time to just pick up a ton of fantasy literature that has been waiting in my house, and I've been reading it.
I assume you don't have a lot of other things to do in the army. There aren't a lot of other ways you can spend the time besides sleeping and working.
Well, when you have free time and you have to stay in the base, nobody's gonna bother you, so you can do pretty much anything that isn't illegal, or at least not frowned upon. So I decided to just get a bunch of books and read them. And this will also be part of today's episode, because in this episode we will be taking a look at 2019 and how it was for us regarding the hobby. Before moving on to this, I'd like to mention that this episode is sponsored
by us.
Haha! Actually, there is a sale on Enchanted Tools. It's a 30% discount. You can check it out. I will leave a link on the show notes, or you can find the link on any of my social media or blog. But let's move to the first thing we want to talk about.
Which is books.
Yeah, I had an idea of checking out what books we read this year. So I made a list. And I made some really, really short reviews. Or pretty much my thoughts on what books I read. So I'm gonna go first. And the first book I read was the Icewind Dale trilogy. I am counting it as one because I got the Omnibus edition. It's the first trilogy that was written by Salvatore. Of course, it is set in the Forgotten Realms and introduces the companions of the Hold to us, which is Drizzt, Wulfgar, Catibri, Brunor and Regis. I don't really have to say it, but the writing is very beautiful. What I really liked as someone who has been already introduced to D&D is that you can find concepts of it in the writing, but it's done in a way that feels natural.
Which I think is quite important, because otherwise I suppose it reads like a game manual or something and that would take you out of it.
Which I'm going to come back on that on another book. Yeah, the trilogy is very adeptly connected and it doesn't feel forced. You move fluidly from one book to the other without feeling that there is any force from the author to connect the books.
Yeah, I understand.
What I also liked is that in the books, all of the main characters faced some sort of internal struggle or challenge to their character.
I think this is the most important part of the book, of any book, really.
For most of the characters, that happens, that takes place in the span of one book, but since Drizzt is the main overarching protagonist, there is also a challenge for him that takes up all three books. But this happens in a way that is kept on the background without overshadowing the main story. Again, it's a really classic book to read, and I don't think I'm going to say something that hasn't already been said, but I really suggest reading it if you're interested in learning more about the Forgotten Realms. It's a really nice trilogy, but I suggest first reading the prequel trilogy, because I really like reading the books in a chronological order of...
of the in-universe.
Exactly. So read the first trilogy first. And if you can, just get the omnibus versions. Moving from a really, really good book to a book that has left me thinking. The Mark of Nerath. It was one of the books that was in the Dungeons & Dragons series. It wasn't a Forgotten Realms or Eberron or anything. It was just Dungeons & Dragons. And it is set in Nentir Vale, which is the main setting of 4th edition. I don't really know how to start, because I think I have more complaints than praises about this book. It's a part of the Abyssal Plague storyline. It is supposed to be able to be read as a standalone novel. After reading it, I'm not sure if this is true. Because if you're like me and you don't like having a lot of loose ends, you're not really going to enjoy the ending. Because it's full of loose ends. Because it is connected with four other novels, I think. That was an issue I faced.
If I could interject here, I think I haven't read it, but this, I think, kind of reminds me of some of the Warhammer 40k novels. For example, since they sort of assume that you already know certain things about the setting, at least from how you describe it, so they can afford to sort of leave these things open. For example, in Warhammer 40k, when you read about Siafa's Kine, you sort of, it is expected that you already know about the Tyranids or the Necrons or the Orcs or whatever, or that what the Commissars are and the Imperial Guard. So, and they are also part of a larger universe, which is explored in other books. So I assume that this was the thinking, that the readers already know or are going to read the other books. So it is standalone in the sense that the main part of the story, the character you are focused in, has his own story which begins and ends within the book.
Sort of, but not exactly, because the story continues to the next novels, so...
But are the next novels, do they have the same protagonist, for example? Do they follow the same...
I believe the characters, at least some of them, move to the next novel. There are a lot of characters in this book. They are introduced very quickly, and you don't know exactly who the main character is. I think it's pretty much an introduction novel to the Abyssal Plague storyline.
Yeah, I understand.
So... yeah, there is a story in this book that ends, but the story continues, and the way it was written felt like it ended abruptly, and the loose ends were there just to make you...
interested in the rest.
So that's one thing. The second one is that the writing feels very technical, in the sense that it feels like someone played a few sessions and made them into a novel. Sometimes it feels like you can see the combat and each character taking their turn.
You said that this was for the fourth edition, right?
Yeah. Which,
from what I remember, was indeed more focused on technical. For example, I remember it was the default was that you had a grid to fight.
Yeah.
And you were like this 5 feet or 2 squares or whatever. So everything was more mechanical than in 5th edition, which is a bit more loose with the rules.
Yeah, but still, so if you...
I'm not saying it's excusable.
No.
Or that I'm just saying it, I assume that this was the influence.
Yeah, but still you can compare it to the previous trilogy I mentioned. So the character casts magic missile. It's almost like that. Yeah, I think there were mentions of spells by their name.
Yeah.
And it felt a bit weird, especially after I finished reading the Icewind Dale trilogy and moved to this. The difference in the writing style was really, it was huge. I think a reason why that is because the author is actually a Dungeons & Dragons designer. Bill Slavisek was a director of R&D for Dungeons & Dragons. So their occupation bled through to the writing.
Makes sense.
I don't regret neither buying nor reading it, but I just need to get all the Abyssal Plague books and read them to get a better feeling of how this story ends, because there were some loose ends. And they're not even exactly loose ends, because I really don't want to spoil it, but some characters kind of die, but I don't think they die, and I'm really confused about that.
I would be too.
But the really cool thing is that in each of the Abyssal Plague books, there is an excerpt of a prequel novel that actually introduces to the Abyssal Plague. And if you get all of the books, you can read all of the novel. It's a 75-page novel that predates the Mark of Nirath. And I think this has to be free somewhere, because it was released by Wizards of the Coast at some point. But let's move on.
Okay, so to be honest, I haven't been reading as many books as I used to quite a few years ago, but there's a book that I try to read at least once a year because I like it a lot. It's quite old, and it's called The Siberiad. It's from Stanislaw Lem. It's essentially, well, it's science fiction, first of all. And it's a compilation of short stories. It's about two robots, which are called, they have quite the unique names. One's called Trerl, and the other is called Klapaukis. And yes, those are their names. And they're essentially these extremely advanced constructors, or however you want to call them. They can build pretty much anything they want. The book contains several stories about their adventures. Some of them have some philosophical issues and problems, like a very common theme is the nature of happiness. Like, how can you be happy, or a society be happy? And I don't want to spoil it with an example, because they are very nice, and I suggest you read it. I think several chapters are free online. And it's also pretty funny. It has some short stories that are purely for laughs. And in my opinion, very important thing is that there was an excellent work on the translation, because both in the Greek version and the English one that I have read, they have done excellent work, because the original text involves a lot of jokes, a lot of wordplay, which is very difficult to translate. And in one chapter there's even poetry, which is even worse, to try and do it accurately. It's, I'd say, one of my favorite books. Have you read it? I think I have lent it to you once.
No, but you've shown me a few chapters.
Probably, yeah.
I have a comment on the translation part. This is extremely surprising for a Greek translation to be good.
Yeah.
I mean, we've seen so bad translations, and not just in literature, in technical books. Just imagine that there are technical books about computer science that are so badly translated that they have grammatical errors on the word grammar.
Yeah, that was quite fun to see. Also, since you mentioned technical books, it has a lot of jokes and wordplay about mathematical terms or computer terms, since it's, well, science fiction and all that. Also, kind of a funny thing is that even though the main characters and pretty much everyone are robots, and they have spaceships and, you know, rocket launchers and all that stuff, a lot of stories take place in, like, medieval civilizations where there are knights on cyber steeds with cyber swords and that sort of thing. It is a fun contrast to mention.
Let's move on to the final trilogy that I read, which I'm really excited about. I finally finished it. It is set in a world that we both really like for its theme and feeling. That world is Eberron. The trilogy is called The Heirs of Ash, and it is written by Rich Wolf. It focuses around the chase for clues about what happened to a Decanith artificer that was very well known, and what his greatest invention is, and where it is, or how they can recreate it. That invention has the potential to reignite the last war, which was a 100-year war that ended with the destruction of a whole nation. I'm really trying not to spoil anything. So that artificer was lost in the Day of Mourning, and this is somewhat connected to the plot. I'm not going to say anything more about the story, because I really suggest you should read this if you're interested in Eberron, for various reasons. One is that you see a lot of places. This trilogy is written as a challenge against time, because there are parties that are interested in finding as quick as possible what has happened to that artificer, or how to get to his invention, question mark, because it's not exactly an invention. That's the last thing I'm going to say about the story. As you can see, I'm really excited. Anyway, this is a challenge against time, so the pace is really, really fast. You see a lot of places, because the characters travel with an airship, so they move pretty much to all of the continent, the main continent, at least, of Corver, the one with the nations. I believe the story slows down a tiny bit in the second book, but then the pace goes really, really up again, especially in the third book. Because in the third book, the story takes place in the span of just a few days, but still they manage to travel through half the continent again. As I said, it's really, really good. It's very well written. It shows a bit how the Day of Mourning has affected everyone in the world, as well as it shows parties that are interested in reigniting the last war. While there are quite a few characters, the author does a really good job at introducing them to us very naturally. Most of them are introduced in the first book, but it doesn't get heavy, so it's not gonna be like you're reading The Silmarillion.
And yeah, in the first page there are 20 names.
Yeah, no, it's nothing like that. It's very naturally done.
I mean, The Silmarillion, you wouldn't call it unnatural. It's just there's a lot of people involved.
Yeah, but
also, yeah. Everyone is related to each other, so that's a bit extra information.
The Silmarillion is probably more like a historical book than a literature book. Again, if you're interested in Eberron, I really suggest you should read this trilogy. It's amazing. I'm going to mention a few books I want to read in 2020. And most of them are really classic when it comes to Dungeons & Dragons. First of all, I want to read the original Dragonlance trilogy. And I have already bought the omnibus for it. It's Dragons of Autumn Twilight, Dragons of Winter Night, and Dragons of Spring Dawning. I really want to get into Dragonlance, especially since the owner of the LGS highly recommends I should read it. So it's one of my next reads. Moving on, I want to read the next... it's not a trilogy, it's actually four books. The next story in The Legend of Dridst. It's actually four books. The Legacy, Starless Night, Siege of Darkness, and Passage to Dawn. Moving on, I want to try Matt Colville's writing. So he has written two books, The Priest and the Thief, and I'm interested in seeing how he writes. And finally, not D&D related, but a really good series to start reading. It's the Discworld series, and I'm going to start with The Color of Magic.
Well, first of all, I would like to finish Neuromancer. A friend bought it for me, and I still haven't read all of it. It's interesting. It's, well, I think most of you know it. It's what started the whole cyberpunk genre. It's also part of a trilogy. I'd like to finish that, if I could. Also, a very classic book of science fiction that I still haven't read is the fourth book in the Space Odyssey series. I've read the three first, but not the last one, the Odyssey 3001. And you have also bought me a large book, which is a collection of classic science fiction stories. I want to read that, if possible.
I kind of want to read that as well. If I remember correctly, it's from various authors. Yeah. So you get an example of the writing style. Yeah.
You bought me along with that the Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, which is the book that Blade Runner was based on. I have seen the movie Blade Runner, the original one. I think the book would be interesting as well.
As a movie, it was really good.
Also, I just remembered, since we're talking about books and films, I, Robot. Well, the movie, I'm not going to talk about it. The book, however, is, I think, well, everyone knows it. It's one of the best science fiction books ever written by Asimov. It's again a collection of short stories that are all connected with each other and poses some very interesting questions about artificial intelligence.
Well, I see you're very interested in science fiction.
I would say I prefer it to fantasy, but it's not like I'm opposed to fantasy as well. Anyway, that's it about books. We could sit here and talk about them for days, but I think we could move on to another topic.
Which is still relative to them, because while we're moving away from Dungeons & Dragons and fantasy and sci-fi literature, we're staying to tabletop RPG gaming.
Yeah, so this year we played very few games, I think.
Yeah.
But we were both... We had many difficulties with our schedule. Because you had your own stuff with the army, getting ready, and that was months not being available.
The army was since October. It was an issue since October. And most of 2019 was me struggling to finish... my college degree as fast as possible,
too,
because since last year, no, it's not, now it's technically 2 years ago, my father had a heart attack, so I had to finish as quickly as possible, so...
And well, beside that, there was also the thing that, first of all, we started playing Dragon Heist.
Yeah.
Did we start this year or last year? Last year, I think.
Technically, it was last year, because now it's 2020. I think we started in 2019, around April.
Anyway, but in the beginning it was just me and Nicole. So, two players plus you as the GM, we could make it work. But then we had like three or four extra players come on.
Three.
And we had a lot of schedule conflicts, so we were we'll play next week, and next week came and we still couldn't play, and this kind of kept going.
We had university schedule issues. Nicole isn't currently living in the same city with us. The two others are working. One of them lives in another city for half of the week. So this isn't
and
easy...
The days that one of them is free, the other is working. So
exactly. So it wasn't easy to schedule things. But we still managed to
get a few sessions. Yeah.
And we also managed to get a new player.
Yeah.
And she's interested in the game. And also, I think she is going to be really good at role-playing because she has some theater background. When we had those sessions with her, she got into role-playing quite fast.
Besides that, we also started another campaign.
It's not exactly a campaign, we say it's kind of like a West March-style campaign because it's one-shot sessions that are very loosely connected so that we keep the setting, the theme, but we shift through players and GMs.
Yeah, and it's pretty much just short dungeon crawls.
Yeah.
But
that's not bad. I like dungeon crawls.
Yeah, that's fun, I think.
Dungeon crawls is something personally I enjoy both running and playing. Moving on. Let's talk about Kickstarter for a tiny bit. We backed the latest Matt Colville Kickstarter. We call it Matt Colville. It's actually MCDM Productions, but...
Yeah. Kingdoms and Warfare, I think it's called. Yeah.
I'm really interested in seeing how this book develops because... If you've listened to or read the review, we're kind of expecting a sort of closure to the Strongholds and Followers because there are mentions to this next book in Strongholds and Followers. So I kind of believe that this book is going to be the next tome of
a series.
Pretty much you could say that it's actually the second chapter of Strongholds and Followers. And we didn't back any other Kickstarters, right? No, I think I backed...
don't think so.
No, I backed a card game. No, it's a board game with cards. These are two different things. At some point, there's going to be an unboxing and sort of me explaining the rules for that Kickstarter.
Next topic.
Now let's move to something more personal, as in something that we're really invested in. And this is publishing. We have published the Enchanted Tools supplement.
Which I would say, personally, I'm very proud of.
Yeah, I'm really happy with how it turned out, because it's the first supplement we tried to be as professional as possible. We used professional software to do the layout, we got art, we did a lot of editing for the writing in order to make it as good as possible. And I'm really proud of that as well. And hopefully we'll be able to publish a few things before you go to the army. Hopefully, if things stay as they are, I may be able to do some work.
Yeah, we have been working on and off on some things. They're not finished yet, but I think we have done some good work. There are a lot of things we're working on.
Yeah, we have a folder that has a ton of...
like
ideas,
6-7 projects, and a lot more of ideas that aren't fully developed.
But some of them are, I'm not gonna say close to finishing, because
but the
writing is close to finishing, then we have to move to editing, art and layout, but if we finish the initial writing, things will be much smoother, I think.
To give an example on, should we give an example on what we're working for?
Sure, why not?
One project is about artifacts, and generally I think artifacts should have some unique effects on the game. And magic items in general, but especially artifacts, they should essentially change the way you play entirely, and not in purely a your numbers get bigger way. They should give you something unique. And we have, I think, several artifacts that are... almost ready. I think they are very interesting.
Yeah, we've been working on artifacts way before we finished Enchanting Tools.
Yeah.
as we're working on a project, we keep expanding it, and that's an issue. Another interesting project is, you can call them micro settings, or just locations you can drop to your world. So you have a small area that is packed with cool stuff in it, pretty much. I've been working on one, and I've been thinking of a second one. But the first one is going to be really good, I think. It includes a floating island.
Yeah, I think it has some good stuff in it.
And again, we keep expanding it, but we'll get there. And speaking of work, we'd like to talk a little bit about the rest of our outlets, which are the blog, this podcast, and YouTube. Again, due to all the priority change in 2019, I haven't been able to work as much on the blog as I wanted. But still, we did make some progress both on the blog, but also on YouTube.
Yeah, I think we did a lot of work on YouTube this year.
By the way, go subscribe. It's a really good channel. I'm not biased at all, anyway. Yeah, we're kind of getting the hang of it. We've been mostly doing unboxing videos, but...
But I think we could do a lot more stuff.
Well, I consider YouTube as an outlet I can use to have fun with. I don't necessarily need to stay on tabletop RPG-related content.
Yeah.
I just think it's a fun way to express yourself. And either through unboxing videos or I don't know what else. Maybe I remember doing a map drawing video that... And, of course, we'll be uploading the podcast there as well.
We're still working on what exactly we want to put on the podcast. Also, we'll have to have some sort of schedule.
I think with the current situation, maybe an episode a month could be attainable.
Maybe, but we'll have to see.
Also, guest-wise, I think we could have some guests. This would probably increase the... complexity, because it will have to be done through the internet, because, you know, we're in Greece. Yeah. But cool technology can help us.
We live in the future.
Yeah.
Everything is possible.
Do you want to see guests? Let us know. Also, let us know if you want to be a guest. That would be also interesting. And finally, I want to talk a tiny bit more about the blog. Because it's the main outlet, it's the thing I started with, and I have a deep respect for it. So while I'm grateful for it, I haven't been treating it very well the last year. I'm not gonna repeat myself, things were hard, didn't write much. The content was a bit stagnant in the sense that the main two pieces of writing for me on the blog where the Unearthed Arcana analysis articles and the reviews. Not that I have any bad feelings about those, but I think I can write more, I can do more. I'd like to diversify the content a bit. And also, I really, really, really need to reorganize the website. And hopefully get better hosting when I reach the Patreon goal. Speaking of Patreon, it is an amazing tool. It's an amazing opportunity to improve your work. The support you get for it is really important for that reason, especially when you are from a country that isn't really welcoming to creators of this community. At least that is what I've seen in the Greek communities.
Yeah, we are a bit behind on that front and many others.
I still haven't got used to it, because it has infinite potential, which makes me feel like I'm in deep water, because I can go anywhere, I can do anything, and no matter how much I work on Patreon, I always feel I can do more tweaks, I can do more, and I haven't said yet that my Patreon has reached an adequate level of quality. I really want to make... changes to my Patreon page to improve it, both for me and my patrons and the future patrons. If you're interested in supporting me this way, you can go to patreon.com/thekindgm and check out what I offer here. I will be adding more content soon. And at this point, I'd like to give shoutouts to my very generous patrons. And I'm going to start with Foot of the Mountain Adventures. He's a great cartographer, but also creates some RPG content as well, which I really enjoy. I've seen some of his work and it's really good. You should check him out. He also has a Patreon page. Next, I want to give a shout out to Mick Barbarian. He again has been one of my first patrons and I am very grateful to their support. Moving on to Dragons in Dungeons. They have a Patreon page as well, and again, they started supporting me almost right as I opened my Patreon page. They have a ton of experience in publishing, so I really want to interview them at some point. And finally, we have Anastasios here.
Hi.
Who has not only been supporting me on Patreon, but in all of my creative endeavors, as well as giving me moral support and also being an extremely good friend. That's all of them for now. Again, if you want to support me, you can either go to my Patreon page or my Ko-fi page. I have one as well. But another very important way you can support me without giving any money at all is consuming my content, sharing it, and saying a good word about it. And that's all for this episode. So, again, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
And until next time, have fun.
Have fun.